Congregation, please stand. Dying Christ destroyed our death. Rising Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, Floyd, Galloway, Buddy Villines III put on Christ. So in Christ may Buddy be clothed in glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him just as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ himself is pure. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Because I live, you shall live also. Friends, we are gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Buddy Villines. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we might find comfort, in sorrow hope, and in death resurrection. Congregation, I invite you to remain standing as you turn in your hymnals and we sing number 261, Lord of the Dance.
Please be seated. And let us unite our hearts together as we pray the prayer of thanksgiving. God of love, we thank you for all with which you have blessed us, even to this day, for the gift of joy and days of health and strength, and for the gifts of your abiding presence and promise in days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and friends, and for our baptism and place in your church with all who have faithfully lived and died. We are grateful for Buddy, who blessed our lives and who now lives with you. Above all else, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our griefs, who died our death, and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us. Amen. And now let us continue to praise God as we recite the 100th Psalm responsively. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with singing. Know that the Lord who made us is God. We are the Lord's. We are the people of God, the sheep of God's pasture. Enter God's gates with thanksgiving and God's courts with praise. Give thanks and bless God's name. For the Lord is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. God's faithfulness to all generations.
I start our personal witnesses today with a letter from former President Bill Clinton. Hillary and I wish we could be with all of you today as you celebrate the wonderful life of our friend Buddy Villines. He was an extraordinary public servant whose legendary career transformed Pulaski County, beginning with his first election to the Little Rock Board in 1984. He ran all 14 of his campaigns under the theme, Together We Can Make a Difference. Over his 30 years in office, especially his 24 as county judge, he certainly did make a difference and did it in a way that truly brought people together. Buddy's legacy will endure across Pulaski County through all the projects that embodied his visionary leadership. The great parks and long trails, the arena, the convention center expansion, and of course, the bridges, more than 80 of them. For him, the bridges not only took people over water, they linked communities. They were the perfect symbol of who he was and how he governed. I'll always be grateful for the chance to work with Buddy. Especially when we were building the Presidential Center, and for the support he gave both Hillary and me as an Arkansas traveler in our campaigns. And I will always treasure his warm, wise, good-hearted friendship. The Lord has called home a good and faithful servant, and while we will miss him down here, I am sure he is already hard at work up there singing in the choir and dreaming up new projects. My heart and prayers are with Bev, Meredith, Corey, and his grandchildren, his entire family, and everyone who loved him. Bill Clinton. And now I invite Meredith Villines to come, and Skip Rutherford will precede her.
Well, I'll start with apologizing to Skip because this may take longer than a couple minutes. I am my father's daughter after all, and he was never short on words. Welcome everybody. Everybody dies. Yes. Everybody dies. This is a lesson shared with me
from my father at a very young age, when we were preparing and then mourning the loss of his father, Reverend Floyd G. Villines, Jr. He shared this wisdom many more times throughout my life to ensure that I would be prepared one day to say goodbye, and that I would grow up embracing the reality of life's impermanence. His hope that I would not look away from death when the time was near and welcome what he believed to be true, that death, a part of life, was just another great adventure. He taught me many more things that were not as morose, like the importance of music, laughter, and family. He taught me how to measure the distance of lightning during a thunderstorm, that my elbow was not, in fact, a penis, and most importantly, that life was a gift, and in order to live a good life, one needed to find ways to elevate joy, love, and grace through service to others. My dad was an avid reader and a devoted Christian, so perhaps that lesson is of no surprise. On the day that he died, when he could barely speak, I wanted to know him more still. So naturally, I looked at what he had on his reading list and what he was planning on learning. The love of learning was one of the many things we had in common. Written on a small piece of paper at the kitchen table where he sat every morning, he had written down three passages. Proverbs chapter 10, the first chapter of Ecclesiastes, and Song of Solomon. From each, what stood out for me was the following. My dad was seeking understanding about love and the meaning of life. He was setting out on a voyage that would ultimately lead to his homecoming. Of course, given the way my mind works, all messy and often oriented in constellations full of connections, this prompted recollections of the many conversations about books, philosophy, religion, theology, politics, activism, and scholarship, about the importance of traveling through time and into the experiences of others through this medium of reading, in order to understand the world and to be able to see the world through another's eyes. One of the only books that my dad and I read together was All About Love by Bell Hooks. This book resonated deeply with us both because even as we grew apart in our political beliefs, with me leaning a little bit further to the left, we both held fast to the shared belief that love is the way, an essential ethic, an avenue, as Hooks describes, to understanding everyday life. But love is a funny thing. In her book, A Natural History of Love, Diane Ackerman declares, love is the great intangible, like faith in God or the universe or whatever your beliefs may be. You can't always see it when it's there, and you don't always know when or how it might manifest in your life. Our definitions often fall short, but I appreciate Hook's perspective and her perceptive descriptions of love as an action, intentional and honest, expressing not only care, but also affection, responsibility, respect, commitment, and trust. For love is as love does. My dad spoke often of the power of bridges, you may recall. From where I stand today, I can see my father's love clearly. I also know it lives beyond this room, these people, and this moment in time. The great poet Rumi declared, "Love is the bridge between you and everything." I see my father's love living in the hummingbirds, flitting around the forest and in my garden. His love lives in the sunrise and sunset over the big dam bridge, in the sounds of frogs, glimpses of salamanders and does as you walk through Two Rivers Park. It can be found on the wind, whistling, rustling through the garden of trees at the far end of this same park. In the whiz of bicycles racing past one another on the river trails, in the music, laughter, and cheers at Simmons Bank Arena, at the river market and farmers markets all around town. My father's love lives on in my mother, my sister, myself, Charles, and his three grandchildren, Hazel, Carter, and Cameron. And it lives in all of you. In her final chapters, bell hooks reflects on loving into life and death. She states, "Love empowers us to live fully and die well. Death becomes then not an end to life, but part of living. On his last day, he pulled me and my daughter close for a hug and then said, 'I've had a good life. I've been happy. I've been happy with my family and my work. I've done good. I'm good.'" In closing, and on behalf of my family, I thank you for being here and for joining us in this celebration of my father's life, his legacy, and the many adventures he is undoubtedly embarking on with his friends and family who've gone before. And remember, everybody dies, but love lives on forever. May his memory be a gift and a blessing. Thank you.
Thank you, Meredith. Buddy Villines was a pillar in our state, in this county, in this city, and certainly in his beloved church. Here at Pulaski Heights, he was active in so many areas. I'll always remember him singing in the church choir. And if I turned around now, I would know exactly where he would be. Buddy loved this place and the years of fellowship and camaraderie he had with his pals. The two of us shared a common bond with public education. Meredith and Blake Rutherford started elementary school together and graduated together from Little Rock Central High School. We both also had great interest in public service and campaigns and elections. We went through many elections together, winning some, losing some, but never second guessing because Buddy was always looking forward. He also had other causes. He loved MacArthur Park and the street Pulaski County Way helped make it more accessible. He was a strong advocate for public transportation, for sidewalks, for trails and bike paths. He championed and embraced environmental stewardship. But he lived politics, and he was so effective because he cared so much about people. As President Clinton noted, Buddy's campaign theme was always, together we can make a difference. But it was more than just a slogan, y'all, or a phrase. That's the way he served. And more importantly, that's the way he lived. When I was on the school board, Buddy once chaired a school millage campaign. When he received the results of a pre-election poll, he called me and said he wanted to talk. Mind you, we were good friends at the time. He walked in with a poll in his hand and said, "The good news, Skip, is we can win this thing. The bad news is that you and the school board members are the least credible ones to campaign for it." So you have to convince the superintendent and the other board members to keep their mouths shut. Don't put anything controversial on the agendas. Meet as infrequently as you can between now and Election Day, and adjourn any meetings you do have as soon as possible. But don't take this personally, he said with a smile. Just look at the numbers, as he tossed the survey to me. I appreciated and understood his candor. We followed his advice, and vote yes for the kids, with Buddy Villines front and center, emerged victorious. In 1997, he called and said, "I'm putting together a coalition of Pulaski County mayors for a campaign to build a new arena and to expand the Statehouse Convention Center. The mayors and I will be out front, but I need you to handle the day-to-day logistics." The River Project was born. And 25 years later, we are still benefiting from that arena and convention center. The three amigos, as Buddy, Jim Daly, and Pat Hayes became known for their work on this and other initiatives, still set a noble example of how elected officials can choose cooperation over competition. When the public history of this time is written, it will be noted that a visionary saw the Arkansas River as a uniter, not a divider, as a connector, not a barrier. One by one, the Junction Bridge, the Big Dam Bridge, and the Two Rivers Bridge, even the arches on the new Broadway Bridge, were realities all in part, in large part, because of Buddy. When federal officials wanted to tear down the Rock Island Bridge, Buddy spoke up and said, "No." When they threatened to tear it down anyway, Buddy said, "We'll see you in court and we'll keep you there for years." He didn't know at the time how that bridge might be restored, but he did know that if it were torn down, we would never have another one. The now Clinton Park Pedestrian Bridge on the east and the Big Dam Bridge on the west encompass the loop, the trails, and the byways that were championed by Buddy, Mayor Daly, Mayor Hayes, Mayor Mark Stodola, and many others. And the Arkansas River Trail was voted best bike trail in the South by AAA Southern Traveler. Hundreds of thousands of people every year walk, run, bike, and stroll over the bridges that Buddy helped build, restore, and save. As they were last night, tonight the bridges will be lit red, white, and blue, thanks to Mayor Frank Scott and the Little Rock Convention and Visitors Bureau. Go see them. They are in memory of a bridge builder, a placemaker, a distinguished public servant, a Hendrix alum, and a Vietnam War Bronze Star recipient. Beth, Meredith, Corey, the title of that great hymn "Shall we gather at the river?" is also a symbol that unites Little Rock and North Little Rock because of the tireless efforts of your husband and your father, an innovative and collaborative Pulaski County judge. The fruits of Buddy's labor should earn him the title Quality of Life Champion for generations present and generations to come. Yes, we'll gather at the river to walk, to bike, to run, to take pictures, to watch sunrises and sunsets, to show our guests, to recruit students and professional talent, to make convention pitches, to promote tourism. We'll do that and more on accessible bridges that are the envy of countless cities and urban corridors. And when we do, there's a name that will stand tall and one that should be part of every story going forward. Floyd G. Buddy Villines.
Stand. Our scripture lessons begin with Micah chapter 6, verses 6 through 8. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? I invite you to stand for the reading of the gospel as you are able, which comes to us from Matthew chapter 22, verses 35 through 40. And one of them, an expert in the law, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, which commandment is the greatest? He said to him, you shall love the Lord with all your heart. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated.
Let us pray. O Lord, in the silence of this moment, prepare our hearts and our minds to hear your word for us this day, and work your will in our lives. Amen. When we die, every one of us leaves behind some kind of legacy. For some, it's a legacy of service and love. For others, it's some kind of a significant achievement or accomplishment. Still for others, it's an example of faith lived out over the course of a lifetime. For Buddy Villines, it's all of the aforementioned. Buddy was able to do the most extraordinary of things in the world of politics for the greater good of the people of Little Rock and Pulaski County and beyond as mayor and county judge. Much of what he accomplished was a result of Buddy being Buddy. He was a consensus builder who was able to create a base of support for his visions going through all the necessary political channels for the good of the people of Central Arkansas. That is a milestone achievement. Buddy built iconic bridges, biking and hiking trails, arenas. For many years to come, people will benefit from his hard work, dedication, and vision. His legacy can literally be experienced daily by so many of the rest of us. So many have spoken of walking the trails or crossing one of his bridges and immediately thinking of Buddy. I have done the same. I think of one of those trails or bridges, and every time I think of one of the trails or bridges, I also think Buddy's name ought to be on it. Might as well. Since so many of us think about him and thank him for what he did for all of us as we walk and jog or ride across one of them surely ought to have his name on it. Buddy's father was a third-generation Methodist minister. The Methodist Church was in his blood. His dad's motto was, only believe, all things are possible. But he lived out that motto in so many instances. He sang in the choir, and he participated in countless events and worship services and decisions as a part of Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church. Buddy was also a decorated Vietnam veteran, earning the Bronze Star, given for acts of heroism. But he was one who served his God, his church, his nation, his state, his county, his city with distinction. He was a war hero, and a hero to many who knew him and worked with him regularly. And he did it all with integrity. Buddy and I shared a love for reading. He regularly discussed his most recent read with me, and I, in turn, would recommend a good book to him. But Buddy also asked me lots of deep theological questions, and sometimes I wish he hadn't. Buddy was very smart. Buddy was one who thoroughly thought about what he was going to ask before he asked it. But Buddy never stopped wanting to learn about his faith, and I had such great admiration for that. And sometimes I just had to say, Buddy, I don't know. I'll get back to you. Last fall, Kathy Roberts, Buddy, Bev, Susan, and I went to dinner. We had the most wonderful time over good food, good conversation, and yes, good cocktails. While drinking my first gin and tonic, which Buddy introduced me to, I had Buddy's undivided attention, and he had mine as we sat across the table from each other. We talked about faith and politics and good books and common friends. Buddy showed me that evening a lot about the man he was, and I told my wife, Susan, on the way home, I consider that one of the most enjoyable evenings I've ever had since we moved to Little Rock. I really appreciated and respected and loved Buddy Villines. Charles Brooks, Buddy's son-in-law, said to me when he started dating Buddy's daughter, Corey, Buddy told him, if you're going to date my daughter, do it the right way. When Charles asked Buddy for permission to marry Corey, once again, Buddy reminded him, do it the right way. When Buddy's grandsons were born, he reminded Charles of what it meant to be a father, and again, he said, do it the right way. And shortly before Buddy died, he said to Charles, you did it the right way, and I'm proud of you. Buddy could offer that advice because he lived the life of a person who did it the right way. His legacy goes beyond what he did to who he was. He was authentic and real, a straight shooter. He was one who proved politics does not have to be a nasty business filled with those who attempt to denigrate or belittle their respective opponents. Alfred Nobel established the Nobel Peace Prize, honoring those who promoted peace among nations and cultures. Joseph Pulitzer created the Pulitzer Prize, recognizing extraordinary achievements in music composition, journalism, and literature. Maybe we need the Villines Decorum and Dignity Award, given to a politician who builds consensus with the betterment of the constituents at the forefront. Could it be more than just a pipe dream? However, most know that Buddy did not accomplish all of this alone. Bev was by his side so much of the time. In fact, Bev attended many an event with Buddy when other elected officials' spouses did not. As we all know, she could speak her mind. Certainly she could to Buddy. Publicly, she may have been a quiet influence, but we are certain that at home, she freely offered her opinion, and Buddy would have taken it. He was a smart man. That's what loving spouses do. They share their burden by convicting and encouraging, and Buddy knew Bev was a special gift from God for him. As Buddy's health began to deteriorate rather quickly, he was adamant that he did not want to have a feeding tube or a breathing apparatus to keep him alive. He made that clear. Bev honored Buddy's wishes by respecting his decision. That is a terribly difficult situation in which to be put, but Bev's love for Buddy overrode everything else. She gave him a great gift. Even as he died, she let him go. Buddy was ready to go. He knew his life had been filled with faith and love and service, so he was content to enter into his new and eternal home. His faith for a lifetime had prepared him. We are Christians. Buddy was a Christian. That means we cling to our eternal hope found in Jesus Christ, as Buddy did, that promises us death is not the end, but marks a new and glorious beginning that has no end. Jesus was clear. He has prepared an everlasting home for us and will come for each of us when our days here on earth have ended. Jesus came for Buddy, and Buddy was ready to go. Buddy suffered from a number of physical ailments over the last few months. Not anymore. He has no more pain, no more difficulties of any kind. He is fully alive, more so than at any other time in this world. He has been reunited with those who have gone before him, including his father, who I'm sure has said to him already, only believe, I told you all things are possible, culminating with your arrival, Buddy, here in your new heavenly home. For several days, Buddy Villines' death was all over the local television newscasts and newspapers. Positive comments poured in from all sorts of dignitaries from many different places and political persuasions. Each person, without exception, heaped praise on the life and legacy of Buddy. They should have. There was no other choice. The facts spoke for themselves. The accomplishments were unprecedented. The man who served with dignity and integrity earned the right to be praised. He didn't seek it, but it was a natural and heartfelt response by those who benefited from their relationship with him. With all that Buddy earned, his greatest achievement will never be taken away from him. He earned his crown of eternal righteousness because of his faith and service to Jesus Christ. I think when we stand before our Lord, we are not asked, were you perfect? None of us are. But instead, I think the question is, did you try? What I appreciate most about the man named Buddy Villines is that he tried. He tried to be a good servant of Jesus Christ and to his neighbors. He tried to be a good husband and father and grandfather and friend. He tried to grow in his faith. He tried. But Buddy also succeeded. And as a result, he walks the streets of gold, surrounded by the purest form of love, looking into the very face of Jesus Christ himself. We can only imagine in this life what Buddy must be feeling and experiencing right now. Buddy's death has created a void in the lives of many. His family, who loved him deeply, must adjust to life without him. His friends must learn to enjoy the company of others without Buddy's presence. His church has to get used to the reality that Buddy is no longer singing in the choir, attending Sunday school, participating in worship, and all the other activities, Bible studies, or any other things they're used to seeing him do. To all of Buddy's family, I say Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church, as you know, is here for you. Bev has said on several occasions in the last few days, I'm going to be okay because I have a tribe around me. She knows she has a church that loves her and friends who are already caring for her and for Corey and Meredith as well. That's the joy of being a part of a faith community. We never do this thing called life with all its ups and downs alone. Whatever we can provide, please, Bev, you'll let us know. We want to express our love and support any way we can, and for Bev, that's a new thing. She's been the one who oftentimes is giving the love and support. It's her turn to receive it. And Corey and Meredith, you have lost the physical presence of your daddy, but he's still a part of you. Your comments regarding the joy you felt just being with him in simple moments and big celebrations is a testament to your love for your daddy. But if you live and love like he did, and do it the right way, everything's going to be okay. You have such a fine example to emulate. I hope all of you who knew and loved Buddy will make every effort to let his family know how much you appreciated him. Your expressions of love, many of which they have regularly received already, will continually be a healing balm as they walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Mindful that as the psalmist writes, I will fear no evil because your rod and your staff comfort me. Your good wishes will bring them great comfort. God created Buddy. God sustained and nurtured Buddy. And God continues to do just that. As Paul so eloquently stated, nothing can separate us from God's love, not even death. Death for Christians is simply an entryway into a new life, a bridge from this life to the next. Scripture defines God this way. God is love. And since the Bible also states that love never ends, because God loved Buddy, there is no way Buddy can be outside God's eternal love. Even death cannot break apart that love. We are resurrection people, convinced that God's love overcomes all else. That is the summation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. As we often recite in Scripture, in worship, in life and death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Remember what the Apostle Paul wrote to the church at Corinth? If there is a physical body, there is also a spiritual body. When this perishable body puts on imperishability and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be filled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Death, O death, where is your sting? But thanks be to God, who gives us victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. We are all the beneficiaries of Buddy Villines' hard work that he put into his community, into his family, into his neighbors and his friends, into his church for so many years. We can literally see and experience his legacy. His efforts will serve us for generations to come. For that, we are eternally grateful. But more importantly, Buddy's dedication to his Lord, his family, his church, and his friends leave an eternal legacy. He's doing better now than he ever did in this life. He's even more alive than ever before. Buddy is just fine. So for the life and the love and the legacy of Floyd Galloway, Buddy Villines, we give God our deepest thanks and praise. What a fine, fine man Buddy Villines was. And what an extraordinary legacy we are truly grateful for. Hallelujah. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, creator of us all, We give you our deepest thanks today for Buddy Villines. In all we have heard today of Buddy's life and achievements, his drive to make things better, to help people, all people, all of these things came from his belief in Jesus' great commandment to love God with everything you've got and to love your neighbor as you love yourself. Lord, you gave Buddy gifts of vision and insight, leadership, and the gift of love for his fellow human beings. As we say goodbye today, we know that he lives on in all of us and so many more, for he has been your hands and your feet here on earth. Lord, we ask you to surround his family with your grace. Give them courage and strength for the days ahead. Help us be the support they need. Holy God, your love never ends. When all else fails, you are still God. We pray today for one another in our need. May our doubt flee as your light shines upon us. May we feel your mercy, your grace, and your peace. We trust you, God, and we thank you for all Buddy has given us to make us who we are. Now give rest, O Christ, to thy servant Buddy. May he rest surrounded by the community of saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, but only peace, everlasting. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite you to stand as you're able, as together we join in the affirmation of faith printed in your bulletin. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now let us continue standing as together we sing our final hymn, number 68, When in Our Music God is Glorified.
Thank you.
quick instruction before we receive the benediction. As we exit the sanctuary with the family, that is the clergy, we invite you to remain in place as a congregation, standing out of respect and love for the family. They will exit out these side doors, go immediately over to the great hall, the gymnasium, for the reception. We invite you to follow after they exit the sanctuary. We want you to be aware, however, that the main elevator in this building is not working. So if you need assistance to go downstairs, you'll have to go through to Wesley Hall and take that elevator down. If you need directions, there are people out here who can get you where you need to be. We will receive the benediction. After the benediction, we as a congregation, as the family exits, will sing together on eagle's wings. Let us receive these words. Lord God, now as we leave this holy and sacred place, a home for Buddy Villines, a place where he would sing your praises, listen to the spoken word, pray fervently. We know now as a result of all of that, he resides in his new and eternal heavenly home. We thank you for all the great work he did in this world and in this life. He has blessed us in countless ways. And we know in this moment, God, you surround his family, those who loved him so much, with all they need to be sustained. So for the blessing, the love, the life, and the legacy of Buddy Villines, Lord God, how thankful we are. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Let us sing together.